audio taping, video quote recording. I will check with Cindy. I know one time in summer we've had problems with the videotape. Is everything okay? Is that okay?
Yeah, okay.
Okay, great. So we're you're going to be on candid camera, so that. Is there anyone who wants to make a public comment to the commission before we begin our agenda? Okay. And turning to the first piece of the agenda, we're going to be having a violation hearing relative to alleged violation on June 13, 2015. I'm going to read into the record, and if you can't hear me, please ask me to speak up and I'll try to be louder. June 25, 2015, from the commission to 84 Maple Inc., doing business as Doyle's Package Store, 84 Maple Street, Lawrence, Mass. Attention, Timothy Shea, regarding violation of 204 CMR 2.05, permitting and illegality on the licensed premises, to wit, Mass General Law, Chapter 138, Section 34, sale or delivery of an alcoholic beverage to a person under 21 years of age. Dates of violation, alleged violation, June 13, 2015, notice of hearing. Dear Mr. Shea, you are hereby notified that the Northampton License Commission will hold a hearing on Wednesday, September 2, 2015 at 4 p.m. in Council Chambers, 212 Main Street, Northampton, Mass. To determine if 84 Maple Inc., doing business as, is in violation of 204 CMR 2.05, permitting and illegality on the licensed premises, to wit, Mass General Law, Chapter 138, Section 34, sale or delivery of an alcoholic beverage to a person under 21 years of age. The Commission has reviewed a report from the Northampton Police Department as part of a citywide underage liquor service compliance sweep on June 13, 2015. The report alleges that at 6:44 p.m., an underage female entered Doyle's Package Store with only a cell phone and a $20 bill provided by the police. She attempted to purchase a six-pack of, please, I'm probably butchering this name, Yulingling Lager? Thank you. All the help is appreciated. She stated that the clerk did ask for identification. When she told the clerk that she, quote, left it at home, unquote, the clerk rang up her purchase. The underage female left the store with a six-pack of beer, which she purchased for $7.45. When the compliance checks were complete, Sergeant Caputo returned with the girl to Doyle's Package Store, where the clerk was identified as Stephen Shea. The police department's complaint is available in the License Commission's office at City Hall, 210 Main Street, Northampton, Mass. You are requested and entitled to be present at this violation hearing, to be represented by counsel, to present and cross-examine witnesses, and to speak and offer evidence on your own behalf. Please be prepared with all the information you wish to present. Should you have any questions, do not hesitate to contact this office. Sincerely, William Rosen, Northampton License Commission Chairperson. It's a certified mail return receipt, there was a notice, hearing notice attached to a date of violation. Please appear signed by the license clerk. I would like to hear statements, opening statements from both sides. I would ask, I have a memo and a package of documents prepared by Chief Russell Sinkowitz. I believe the chief is now retired, and who do we have from the police department representing? Chief Casper.
Good afternoon.
I would ask if you could come forward and present the opening statement for your department.
I have very little to add beyond what you read. You read the general facts of the case. This was one of our compliance checks that we conduct in cooperation with the Northampton Prevention Coalition. We usually run about two per year. This was one of those. In total, we checked 95 establishments that evening, 80 that were open and that we accessed. We had two violations. This was one of them. The sale was made to a 19-year-old female minor. Happy to answer answer any of the questions, but you've read in all the facts.
Thank you. And is there Mr. Shea or his counsel?
I'm here. My name is Henry Cropsey, and I'm asked to represent 84 Maple Incorporated. With me, I have Steve Shea, who's the president of the corporation, and who is obviously dangerous and employee in violation.
Okay, could you spell, since we are taking this down, could you spell your name and let us know which town you reside in?
Sure. Cropsey, Henry. Last name is spelled C-R-O-P as in Peter, S-E-Y, practicing in Longmont, Massachusetts.
Thank you very much.
So to continue, to give a little extra background, the basic facts are not in dispute. When the customer entered the store, Steve at that point in time was the only employee on duty, and he was attending a meeting in his back office. The customer came in, he went through the cash register, and he asked the customer for a driver's license, all of which is in the record. Unfortunately for Steve, he was distracted by the back office meeting that he had left in order to come cash out this customer, and he failed to follow through. And for that, he is wholly and completely responsible. Steve has had TIPS certification training, so he knows better. The other thing I'd like to point out is that this is the first violation in over 20 years with this particular licensee. Steve himself has been active for over 5 years.
Part-time for over 10 years, full-time, almost full-time for the last 5.
So obviously, the only explanation is that he allowed himself to get distracted, which basically falls down into a human error situation. The only other thing I'd like to mention is that given the ABC's position at the moment in favor of progressive discipline for liquor license violations, I would suggest that the board consider a strong written reprimand to the file, given the fact that this is the first violation in over 20 years, and basically the human error aspect of this situation.
Does either party wish to present any witnesses?
We do have Sergeant Letzheisen here, who's with our department, who oversaw the compliance check that evening. If you had any questions specific for him, he'd be happy to address them.
And Attorney Cropsey, do you have any
witnesses? No
witnesses. At this point in time, I will swear in anyone that is going to testify before us. I would ask them to raise their right hand. Do you swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you?
I do.
Thank you. And at this point in time, I would ask, thank you, Attorney Cropsey, I appreciate it.
My name is Brian Letzheisen, L-E-T-Z-E-I-S-E-N. Sergeant from the Police Department, and I oversaw the alcohol compliance check on June 13th, 2015. As the chief already said, we checked 95 establishments. 15 of them were closed or only open to those with a ticket. So in all, 80 businesses were actually checked. Two were found in violation. One of them was Doyle's Package Store at 84 Maple Street. As the chief said, the 19-year-old female walked in with $20 in her cell phone. She attempted to purchase a six-pack of Yingling Lager. She stated she placed the beer on the counter and clerk asked her for identification. She stated she left it at home and made a gesture like it was an accident. The clerk then began to ring the purchase up. She exited the store with a six-pack of beer, which she stated she purchased for $7.45. She described the clerk as a white, middle-aged male, grayish hair, red flannel shirt. And after the checks were completed, Detective Sergeant Caputo, who's also assisting with the compliance check, returned to Doyle's Package Store, and the female identified Mr. Shea as the clerk who sold the beer. That's essentially the facts.
Thank you.
don't ask, we give these minors very simple instructions to go in with the money, only their cell phone.
I just wondered if this 19-year-old might have said he ran off into the back room after he rang me up or something.
No, she didn't indicate that.
Thank you for your testimony, appreciate it.
Do you have anything that you want to?
No questions.
No questions.
Well, basically, you know, we've got a situation here. I'm going to move to close the hearing unless the police department has anything further they wish to add. Or, Mr. Shea, if you or council have anything further, you've made a pretty comprehensive statement, and we appreciate that. So I'll move to close the hearing at this time. Hearing nothing. All in favor?
Aye.
These are always difficult because I hear the good faith, and I certainly understand that human error and just plain, it's a bad day, people make mistakes. And I'm looking at, we keep a summary, a running summary of folks who've had violations in town. You know, basically what we're trying to be good about, making sure that the punishment is in accordance with both the applicable regulations, but also that's fair, that it's what we've done with other folks. And while I hear, and I really appreciate candor and acceptance of responsibility for mistake, we also, as an enforcement agency, have some responsibility to set a standard in the community that everyone will honor. So I'm going to turn to my co-member to find out what his thoughts. I'm certainly thinking that there has to be some form of consequence.
Well, I understand that, you know, they would like to have a letter, you know, that's so warranted for the file and so on. Something more along the lines of like 1-day suspension of 3 months, suspended for 3 months, you know what I mean? Or something like that. It is what it is. We have to keep you on our toes.
I think that would be, from my point of view, you know, as long as it's something suspended and if nothing further happens during that period of time, we basically made our point. And if there should be, heaven forbid, a recurrence, then there is an actual punishment on the books that we can go ahead and move forward with. I would be perfectly happy. I don't feel comfortable with just a letter. That's not enough. It's a serious enough thing. We've had some just for folks in the audience, we've had some real difficult situations from last year with you know, young people from the university determining that there were folks in town who were quite close to themselves, underage, and making a beeline, and setting up social networks.
I don't think that this is the same case.
No, not at all. But I'm just saying we have to make sure that people understand that in Northampton we take this very seriously.
So how about I make a motion to remove the suspensions?
I would second that.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you very much. I appreciate the police department's time and attention, and I appreciate
Thank
Mr. Shea
you.
Coming and
Thank you.
Being candid.
Thank you. Thank you.
And I'll state the outcome of the vote was 2-0 with one absent member. The written decision will be given. A lot of people are waiting. Number 6 discussion of Arts Night Out with Ms. Burke. Welcome, Ms. Burke.
Hello. I'm Ms. Burke. I'm here.
Ms.
executive director for North Hampton Center for the Arts, we're the fiscal sponsors for North Hampton's Arts Day.
And here, Bill says regrets and really wishes he could be here tonight.
Yes, I did see him in the supermarket recently.
The fact of the matter is, we have some concerns we hope that you can address.
Yes.
We were caught a little flat-footed at a summer meeting when someone who has no real connection to the arts community, a business, a local business, will remain nameless, came in and asked for a special permit to prevent, you know, basically to serve wine and soft drinks at their local professional office as part of Arts Night Out. And they went so far as to say, well, they hadn't found an artist yet, but they had paintings on their walls. This caught us up. This was never our intention. We're already working very close, if not almost over the ABC finish line, about giving out this kind of an umbrella permit. So we wanted to talk to you about how this is being marketed, because it was never our intention. And this is supposed to be a two-way discussion. We are not here in any way to say this is a bad thing, because we all support the Arts Night Out, and we want it to continue. We don't want the ABCC, which does independent spot checks, we don't want them to ride into town and basically tell us we're not doing what we're supposed to be doing, and perhaps end what is a wonderful thing. So I'm sort of wondering, has there been marketing to just through the chamber or something?
Not at all. Originally, by the way, though, Arts Night Out was a chamber event, and after the Center for the Arts took it over, literally it became apparent to us that not only just on Arts Night Out, but throughout history in the city of Northampton, there are art openings at galleries, many, and I'm sure it's still going on, but I'm not really here to address them, where bottles of wine are open, they're served by the artist, and it's kind of, it's a custom. So this compromise with Arts Night Out and the License Commission, which is, I mean, I can call it a compromise, it was a really very wonderful gesture, because we felt that if we weren't able to have some form of maybe beer or wine served at some of these openings, that it just had a negative effect altogether on downtown. And it is 3 hours once a month on Friday. Before I address the specific case that you're, or instance you're talking about.
I don't think we have to name the business.
No.
I prefer not to do
No,
that.
We don't need to. I will say that, you know, Arts Night Out encompasses not just nonprofit galleries, but as you know, like Don Muller Gallery or Kathy Cross, Jay Rich. I think it's important to know, like, say, Kathy and Nancy at Jay Rich are a part of the Arts Night Out license, and yet they have it because maybe twice a year they have a special event, like a fashion show or a trunk show, where inside they offer refreshments. And I would say that on the list, of course, the list of Arts Night Out members is greater than the list of people who appear on the license. In other words, we ask them if they want to be a part of this license. I'll give you a very recent example. I can't exactly remember the name of them. It's a cardiology. So there's a cardiology office that's doing art openings, and they joined Arts Night Out, but they're not interested in having a license. They're going to serve refreshments, but they're going to be non-alcoholic refreshments. So I guess what I'm trying to say is that the license is there. The Center for the Arts has a license. As you know, we're closed right now, so we sort of own a license. We have a license that we never use. So there are a lot of people who aren't using them, and I would say for the most part, I mean, I think I could almost name, if I had to, the people who are on this list of licensees who use it on a regular basis. And again, I'm just going to give one example. I'm going to pick Ode, which is a women's clothing store. They do something special every Arts Night Out. They have an artist usually on site, and they serve refreshments, including alcoholic refreshments. So there are this, I'm not going to name this particular business, but there are some circumstances around it that I guess I would just like to inform the committee, the commission about, which is they wanted to join Arts Night Out, but because we only do the map every 3 months, they didn't have any exhibitions that were lined up for those first 3 months because they weren't on the map. I had a long discussion with them about what artists they were going to be showing. So I took it at face value that once, I think it's October, that they can get on the map, that they would, you know, that they would have a regular gallery show. In the meantime, you know, the way we've worked it is, I come in once a year, and on behalf of a number of members of Arts Night Out, I apply for this license. Anybody who wants to join Arts Night Out in the interim has to come before you, and I feel, at that point, I sort of step back. I've done my job. I've done my job. I feel I've vetted the people who I'm asking the license for. I know that there was someone who came in 1 month after I had been here. You know, I question whether or not I should be actually naming specific names. But I would say, for example, like if you, there are some doctor's offices and physician's offices that actually appear as members of Arts Night Out. These are people who have strong connections to the arts community, whether or not they are family members or people who work there, or sometimes patients. I mean, Salon Hurtis is a member of Arts Night Out. They're obviously a hair salon, but they have a new art show every month. They don't happen to be, they don't want to have a reception on Friday night. So I guess what I'm saying kind of is, there are some gray areas, but for the most part, when somebody asks to join Arts Night Out, we ask, well, you know, what about you makes you part of the arts community, basically. And if you look at the, I mean, it became an issue for us, this is well before the license, that when we do this Arts Night Out brochure, we divide, we have two categories. One's called galleries and museums, and the other is called arts venues. And a lot of these businesses are appearing under arts venues, including, I might add, something like Big Wheel Press at the Guild Art Supply, which you can't fault, you can't really argue with the fact that there isn't art that's going on there. I'm not talking about just the store, I'm talking about the printmaking that goes on there, so.
Right. And we don't have a problem with that. I think what we're trying to, in our own mind, because we really were caught off guard, and frankly, we did something that I think if we had already approved one business and had a second one come forward and said, no, we don't have an artist, no, we won't have anything until October, but you just approved that person, how can you turn us down? And we don't want to be treating people differentially. So I think what we're going to be doing, Penny, is deliberating at the next couple of meetings about what should we come up with, some kind of overarching criteria that public, you know, that we basically place people on notice that this has to have some real connection. It can't just be a marketing ploy for this, you know, it because it opens the door to everybody who is a business deciding to serve under this already fairly stretched thin under the state regulations license. Serving, you know, wine in their stores. You know, suddenly, you know, I'm just trying to think. Broadside is, you know, every night you know, and obviously this is once a month, et cetera, so we're going to. I'm just placing you on notice. We want as much input, and we're happy to hear from anybody in the arts community. We don't want to dampen the arts community. We want to support it, but we need some kind of criteria so that we don't find ourselves in a situation where we feel that wasn't the best decision, the most prudent decision.
I completely understand it. And again, just to kind of emphasize it, in a way, we do the same thing when somebody wants to join Arts Night Out. And this has absolutely nothing to do with the alcohol component. It has to do with...
You're kind of pre-qualifying them as it is, which you're saying. So,
right.
We're trying to.
Yeah.
We're doing the best we can. Sometimes it's a new business where we're really not sure. I don't want to keep everybody here too long, but I'll tell you, for example, there's a new business that's going to be starting in town in January. They came to talk to me today about Arts Night Out, and they were saying, would we qualify to be a member, even though we're a business, if on Friday night from 5 until 8, we turned our space into what's called a maker space. That means invite people in order to make art and to be taught about art and to do art. Well, it would definitely be, I would just tell you, you know, I think it would be the inclination of the Arts Night Out Committee to say, absolutely, why wouldn't we want this as a part of this event? As far as how much serving alcohol would have to do with that, I leave that.
I was going to say, it's got a pottery wheel involved. Alcohol with no. Okay. Well, I really, really appreciate you taking the time, and I'm going to ask whether or not my colleague has any.
I don't. I think that I agree with what she said. She's kind of pre-qualifying everybody. And her whole point was, you know, our board is telling us we just don't want to get, like you said earlier, everybody out there with a business, and before you know it, there's 50 people out there, Arts Night Out, that have nothing to do, no artists, no nothing, just, yeah, come in and check out our paintings. And by the way, I build homes, and I this, and I that, and so on and so forth, so.
Absolutely.
And we have a lot of alcohol here, so have a good time.
I think this is all, you know, founded to actually promote local artists and help them along. I mean, that's what we want to keep it as, right?
Right. I will say that part of it goes, I want to be honest about it, it goes a little bit further than that. I mean, it is part of what you would call the creative economy and building business downtown, bringing people, because remember, this started in the chamber. So I want, it was modeled after Brattleboro's Arts Night Out, which is very, very successful, in which you have not only galleries and museums participating, but you would have a restaurant with art on the wall, or you know, might have a retail establishment with art on the wall, so.
All right. And Vermont is a wonderful state, but it doesn't have the glorious ABC in Boston that we have to be accountable to. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Appreciate your time.
Thank you.
Let's see, next on the agenda, an application for seasonal wine, malt, and common victualler at Florence Pie Bar. And we have, I believe, Maura Lennon?
Yes.
And Maura, are you the manager of this establishment?
I am a sole proprietor and a manager.
Okay. I was going to say there's a Form 43 approval request I believe we have going on. Do we have all the required documentation sent in?
Everything.
Great.
And there's also, I don't know if I wrote this, there's a request for the confidential there too.
Yes, you do have that. I've seen good write-ups about your...
They're exciting.
I was going to say, I think people are excited. Maybe great blueberry pie is coming to North Carolina.
We can make it before blueberries are out of season. We're getting close.
Okay. Can you tell me a little bit about your business operation, what you intend, et cetera, and your background, just so the commission gets an introduction to who you are?
Sure. Oddly enough, I'm a trained classical pianist. I have a doctorate in music, and I've been teaching at Keene State College for the last 17 years, which is up in Keene, New Hampshire, which is about an hour away. And my family is here, and I've lived here for almost 20 years. And my kids are in school, and I feel like I wanted to be a little closer to home. So we invested in a property where we thought we could open a small shop. And pies are my thing. So I thought a pie shop would be lovely in a small space right on Main Street near Cooper's Corner, where a lot of activity is happening.
And with that lovely new building on the corner there?
Yeah, there's a lot of stuff happening. Florence is bustling. So we've been updating a very antiquated building for about the last 6 months. We've updated all the electrical and all that stuff and taken care of the structure. And we're very close to opening this little pie shop pretty soon, which will be focused on pie. We'll have sweet pie, savory pie, meat pie, pan pies, so Australian meat pies and British pasties and things like that. And for that reason is why I thought it might be nice to have a beer or a wine opportunity, just with a lunch or a late afternoon snack. If it's of the savory variety, I thought it would be well suited. We're not focusing on the bar part. The intent isn't to be a bar. We close at 6 p.m. It's really just to have an added feature to our menu. And the menu focus is really just is the baked goods.
Okay, good. That's great. Is the proposed location within 500 feet of a hospital, spiritual, or educational institution? Then I will make a motion that we approve with respect to the application for a new seasonal wine and malt license. We make a finding pursuant to Mass General Law Chapter 138, Section 16C, that we make the following determination: that the location of the proposed pie shop is not within 500 feet of a hospital, spiritual, or education institution, and that given that, Commission finds there will be no negative impact on educational or spiritual activities by the granting of this license. I would make a motion. All in favor?
Aye.
We'll approve that. Form 43, and again, Cindy, as far as I would make the motion that we approve the wine and malt restaurant seasonal. Would make that motion.
Second.
All in favor? That's also approved. Thank you for appearing and telling us a lot about it. I appreciate your support.
Okay. From
the multitude of other things you've had, the library has. Any questions?
No.
Well, I would make a motion to grant the application for short-term wine and malt license for Forbes Library.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
And I would also make a motion to grant the fee waiver for this nonprofit institution. All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you very much for coming.
Thank you.
Application of short-term wine and malt license, Blue Paws Inc., doing business as JJ's Tavern, 99 Main Street, Unit B, Wine Mass. The event.
Oktoberfest.
Oktober, I was trying to get my.
It doesn't really roll off the tongue like you want it to, but it's kind of.
As long as you can say it to me.
It looks good at times.
Okay, and you would be, sir?
John Newman, owner of JJ's Tavern.
Okay. Why don't you tell us a little bit about this event? Is this first time?
Second time, did it last year, big success. Basically, it's Oktoberfest season. We block off the back parking lot, we have live music, we have entertainment for kids, face painting, balloon animals kind of stuff. We have a traditional German style grill outside where we're doing bratwursts and Bavarian pretzels. And so it's kind of a small scale carnival-y kind of day, afternoon, noon to six.
Tell me about the tips. Tell me what you've got, because my concern always is what's going to happen with the alcohol and how is it going to be controlled?
So 100% of our staff on site is certified. And I think there's a map I attached there showing the parking lot, showing that there's really only one way in because of the way that the parking lot is laid out. One side is all trees and fence line running down this side of the guardrail and parking lot from the adjacent building on this side.
Are you right in back of
The diner.
Flow of flow.
Yes.
Okay.
So where you would normally come through parking your car in the back, that's where you're going to walk in or bike in or however, and then you're going to get checked there. ID, bracelets, everything along with that. And there's no cars, so that's where we stopped it off. The same thing on the back side. We block off maybe, I think it's 75 feet, maybe, something like that.
How do we keep people with open containers from wandering off? That's another.
So, similar situation, we have a person posted at each end, and, you know, vertically, I guess, and then laterally, there's no really way out because of just the way that the parking lot's laid out. So, we had zero incidents last year. It was a really good time. A lot of local people coming off the bike path, stopping in. It was really fun, and we really kind of want to make it a little bigger this year, get more community involved, and just make it our own little event in the village.
You can say it better than I can, but yeah. it sounds fun. This.
No question. I remember it from last year, so.
Okay.
It sounds exactly the same.
All right. I'm going to make a motion that we grant the application for short-term wine and malt license to this applicant.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
One question I had for Cynthia is, if there's a rain date and it's raining out, I can't use it Sunday, is that correct? Or how does that work? If it's...
Posted, I don't know if you guys can grant that now.
Yeah, I never thought about it. We had great weather last year, so there was an issue, but.
So you're proposing October 10th, 2015, and the question is if that's a.
If the Friday forecast says, hey, it's going to be a complete washout Saturday, either.
What would you propose to us? What would you be wanting to do if we could do it? And I'm not saying we
sure.
can.
Sure. I guess a rain date for the same exact event the next day. And if that didn't fall through, then I would just be a non-event. That's all.
It's a new one to me.
Yeah, it's. Yeah. But we would know ahead of time that, you know, because we certainly wouldn't want to put infrastructure and everything out there if it wasn't going to be a washout for food purposes, everything's, you know, so. If you couldn't do it and we just canceled the event, we wouldn't really lose out at all, but just if we could allow it for Sunday somehow.
Isn't our next meeting before the
10th? Yeah, John, what day is your?
The
10th.
So the next meeting is the 7th.
So we can
have him not have to show up, but we can vote on it?
We can vote on it.
Yeah.
Yes,
okay.
Let's post October 11th.
Okay. Yeah.
And, you know, again, we'll be in here on the 7th and you don't have to vote on it.
Okay.
I will make a motion at that point to approve that so that you
we'll
have that.
Okay.
But you have to get the license.
Yeah, that's fine. Oh, yeah, that's fine.
Just work with Cindy. She'll set you right.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Next is an application for farm, winery, to sell at the agro, at an agricultural event, Minerals Winery. Otherwise, Hampshire, Franklin, and Hampden Agricultural Society doing business as Three County Fair. This is coming up this coming weekend. 54 Fair Street, North Hampton, Mass. And who is appearing for Mineral Hills Winery?
Well, I'm appearing for the fair and Mineral Hills.
Okay.
That's fine.
Okay, that's fine. Well, come on up, sir. And your name is?
Bruce Shawcross.
Oh, it's Bruce, sure.
Here's the MDR approval.
Thank you.
So this is a similar thing we've done the past 3 years. We usually have two or three different wineries. This year we only have Mineral Hills. Chance for them to market their wine and their other seasonal products that they do at the fair. It's approved by the Department of Agriculture as a Department of Agricultural event there. We have them in the Crafter Barn. They're next to, across from Active Market, which sells cheese and other products. And it's worked well the past couple of years. People can buy wine there, and it's held for them that when they get home, they get a check, you know, a check slip they pick up and they take it home. They're not allowed to carry it around the fair.
Great. Okay. Well, I think this is fine. This is, I'm sorry to put you on the spot like that, Bruce, but let's make a motion to approve this event, which is totally permissible under state law. I'll make a motion to approve it.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you very much for coming by. Best of luck this weekend.
No, thank you. It's going to be good weather. Come to the fair.
I hope I can get that. Application for short-term all alcohol license. New England Deaconess Association, Rockbridge Retirement Community. There is going to be a founder's dinner. And who is appearing for Rockbridge?
Beth Vittori, the executive director.
Oh, well, welcome.
Thank you.
I don't, have you appeared before us before?
Not to this commission.
Okay. Why don't you tell us?
Can you say your name?
Absolutely. Beth Vittori, V-E-T-T-O-R-I.
And tell us a little bit about the founder's dinner and what you're wanting to do.
Sure, absolutely. Rockbridge Retirement Community has been, was founded about 44, 45 years ago now. And just this past year, we started having an event called the Founder's Dinner. This year will be the second annual Founders Dinner in October, and what we would like to do is, as you've seen, is apply for the short-term alcohol license, the malt and the liquor license. What is it called? The malt.
The all alcohol.
The wine and malt. Yep. So that we can publicly advertise the event. The Founders Dinner is to honor our founders and to give out the Violet Young Community Enrichment Award. It's an award that we last year gave to Suzanne Beck. This year, the recipient is Monty Belmonte. And in doing so, and those are for their philanthropic endeavors, what they do for the greater community. And so the event itself is held right on our campus in our large community room. The food is prepared by our dining services team. We have, it's a, about a 3-4 hour event where the wine and beer would be served by the person noted on the application, one of the chefs. We have two people, well, all of the dining, the cooks are ServSafe certified, but we have the TIP certified director of dining services as well as the gentleman listed in the application, William Goulash. So there'll be the one.
Could you mention that person's name again? I missed
sure.
That.
Yep, William Goulash.
And he is one of your employees?
Yes, he is one of our cooks, one of our chefs. And then, actually, the director of dining services is here as well, Rachel Kane.
Hello.
I will also have my license, and it will be blanketing, so I will be there as well to keep an eye and watch everything. So I am certified.
Okay, great. Because my concern is, it's obviously, it's taking place indoors.
Yes.
And I just want to make sure that you have control over where that alcohol travels.
Yes.
Well, I wish you the very best. I think Monty has done wonderful things in this community, and thank you for honoring him. and all of the works he's done, and I'm going to make a motion to approve this short-term alcohol license.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Approved.
I'm questioning, is it all alcohol or wine and malt that we find?
Wine and malt.
Wine and malt only, because it is checked out as all alcohol, so we wanted it to be wine and malt.
Yes.
So then we need to.
Okay, let's redo this, okay, because I had it on my agenda saying all alcohol, and it's not the same thing. Okay. But they're not looking for, we're not making margaritas in the back kitchen.
I'll not go with that menu.
Okay, let's just try this over again. I'll make a motion to approve a beer, short-term beer and malt license. All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Application for annual pouring permit for a farm brewery, Brew Practitioners LLC. This is per Mass General Law Chapter 138, 36 Main Street, Florence, Form 43 approval request and 16C approval request. You're getting there.
And I did double-check the address that I was going.
Okay.
Good afternoon, and you're representing Brew Practitioners LLC?
I am.
And what is your name?
Tanzania Cannon Eckerly. Would you like me to spell that?
Sure.
T is in Tom, A N is in Nancy, D is in Zebra, A N is in Nancy, I A. Cannon with two N's, hyphen Eckerly, E-C-K-E-R-L-E. Done that.
Yes, I bet you have. Well, thank you very much. You've made it very, very easy for us to be clear. Tell us a little bit about who you are, what you're doing, etc.
Okay. I am the majority owner. We do have five total owners. I am the resident owner. I'm 46% majority owner and minority owner. It is a female majority-owned business. I do have partners in Kansas City, South Carolina, and Indianapolis, Indiana. We do have hopes that we will scale out to those regions, but for right now, this is the
epicenter, perhaps?
Yes. Yes, it is. Reason being is we love this community. We are a farm brewer license because I wholly believe in buy local, eat local, farm to table. And we do source most of our ingredients here as much as we can, although it seems as if most everybody else is doing that as well, so we're having to branch out a little bit regionally. But we are getting our hops, our malt, and yeast here and there from the local package store, but we are finding means to source it locally. We are a brewery that we only brew our own beer. We are a small brewery, 3 barrels. Our max capacity to be able to push out 5,000 beers a month would be maximum, and that would be me brewing continually, me selling continually, and that may sound like a lot of beer, but actually it's not. In relation
take
to-
Take your word for that.
Okay. In relation to the Northampton Brewery, we are about, I want to say, an eighth the size of their brewing capacity.
And where do you market and distribute? Do you do that mostly locally in town, or?
We are actually, because we're a farm brewer, we can market ourselves, distribute ourselves. We have not really marketed anything other than local word to mouth. We intend to be a community-based brewery. I'm an attorney by trade. My full-time brewer is vice president of operations at a multi-million dollar facility. All of our partners are professionals. They have full-time jobs.
These are this is an avocation for many people, I think.
Yes, we, and actually they're all kind of friends. They were all my way. So we are all friends, we love beer, but this was something that we are near and dear to our heart. I've studied beer, it's, you know, I've waited at table, spent 10 years. I am TIP certified as well.
Okay.
And so this is just something we have had on the books for a long time, probably 10, 15 years in plans. This is my eighth state I've moved around. We've been here for about 4 years now, 3.5, 4 years, and we decided that this is the one.
We wanted to do it here. We found a great spot, this catty corner, actually from the Thai bar, right across the street from JJ's. Mm-hmm. And we love Florence. We love Northampton. I actually have served on a commission here. And we hope what happens with our beer, I don't know if you've seen our website or anything, but we look at it as it's an art, and it's cooking, and it's chemistry. And actually, I should have brought my logo, so our logo even actually has the chemistry logo in it. We intend to have not only just us brewing the beer on premises, we intend to actually do some events, educational events and best practices with other breweries. We don't look as if we're in competition with the other breweries. We think it's a community. We hope that because we are one of several popping up, that it will actually make Northampton a destination for brewing. It'll bring people here. I also belong on the board of directors at the CDC in Franklin County. I intend to bring people down here to Northampton because of that, have some events there, whether it be beer dinners, that type of thing. We also are going to have on tap kombucha, which is the Arsene Bev company up in some fermented tea, because it's right along with our, you know, brew practitioners. They are practicing the art of brewing tea and fermenting their tea. So we are kind of, we're a brewery, a small brewery, but not to sound cheesy, but we hope to be, you know, your community place where you can walk down the street and you ask, you know, where the postman is, and he's over at the pub. He's at our place. We're just in it for the love of beer, you know, the love of what we do.
Do you have a location where you're actually selling the beer at this point?
No, we just are waiting on the pouring license. We just received the state okay about a month ago, but then you guys were on vacation, so we've just been brewing and brewing and brewing. Our business model, we are not large enough to actually sell by the keg. We won't make enough beer in order for people to come in and buy beer or sell by the keg. Our goal is not to be on every tap and every bar. We're not going to distribute our beer by the can. It's not going to be a money machine. It's a community place. We also intend to have art at our place, although we will have artists come in. I'm very enmeshed in the artist community. We just have our little place, little 2,000 square foot place where we brew really good beer, and I hope you guys come and enjoy some. We aren't going to be your trendy, extra special hop, cricket beer, whatever it is. We have a classic approach from the European model, and we've been studying it and doing it for a while. We just hope, my long-term hope, is that people learn to take it more seriously, and that it is an art, it's a craft, and hopefully it doesn't become, this is going to sound like so cheesy, but it's an education, and you know, I've studied it in Europe, and the model that we have, we hope to match that in Europe, because the kids don't use it there. You know, they know it's an art, they know that it's something that's to be savored and not, you know, chugged, that type of stuff, and we hope that by bringing that to the community and being able to show people the art behind it, and that you can actually be serious about it, that it'll change kind of the mindset of, you know, how people approach beer and even think about it.
Okay. Well, I was just saying, Henry Hasbrook actually sent an email that I put my hands on right now in support of that they have been accommodating in every way. Yeah, wonderful.
Okay. I appreciate Louis' input on this. And I will say that since we have just investigated at length where the pie establishment is located, I see here we have we need to make a finding pursuant to Mass General Law Chapter 138, Section 16C. We've held a public hearing with notice specifically given to the Roman Catholic Bishop of Springfield, Church of the Annunciation. Following determinations being made that the proposed location of the license is within 500 feet of the Church of Annunciation, that there are other licensed establishments located near the Church of the Annunciation, I know several of them, that given the above, if this commission finds there will be no negative impact on the educational and spiritual activities of the college?
Oops.
I was going to say that, I think, is a typo. by the grant of this license. I will make a motion that we...
The church never picked up their, just so that you guys are aware, never picked up their certified mail, but it was delivered to them.
That's their problem. I guess we'll keep that. Make sure it stays in the file, so we have evidence of notice, because notice was given. If they don't want to pick it up, that is their determination, not our problem. So 16C, I'll make a motion to approve that under the... Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
So we're going to approve that. And then we have the wine and malt pouring permit, and we have everything from ABCC on this. Is that correct, Cindy? Okay, and I saw a check in here. I think we're all set. I'm going to make a motion that we approve the wine and malt pouring permit for this applicant.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
I approve. Thank you. That was quite an education.
Thank you.
No, I appreciate it.
Is there anything that I need to do now?
No, I'll be in touch. I have to send it off to the ABCC for them to approve it.
Okay.
I can comment tomorrow if you want. We can discuss. I'll approach them.
All right. Thank you. Thank you for your time. Have a good evening.
You too. An application for short-term wine and malt. McCollum's Dry Goods LLC, doing business as Cedar Chest. I know some of his followers.
Yeah. Most everybody can.
Yeah, everybody's got a memory somewhere, somehow. Anyway, and you are?
My name is Jody Dole, and I'm the marketing manager for Thorne's Marketplace and Cedar Chest.
Okay. So you're having a grand reopening party on the second floor
of Cedar Chest. Yeah.
Tell me a little bit about the event and what kind, as you well understand from having sat for a long time.
Yep.
We want to know how the alcohol is going to be handled and controlled.
Okay, so Cedar Chest second floor is going under a significant renovation and expansion. We're going to open in a couple weeks, but we wanted to have an official grand reopening party in October. We expect between 100 and 150 people to attend. It'll be entirely held in the 5,500 square foot space of the newly renovated store, which has two doors, a 10-foot wide door and an 8-foot wide door at the second floor hallway. You know, we intend to have 1 6-foot table set up where we're going to have a safe certified server serving alcohol.
And who are you using?
Well, I honestly don't know at this point. We generally hire someone from Paul and Elizabeth's staff when we do this. And, you know, I would understand that the permit, you know, providing the permit to us would be stipulated that, you know, I provide that information to Cindy at the appropriate time.
She's requesting contingent on my receiving the CERPs and the insurance.
Right.
They haven't gotten that yet.
Right. We just set the date and I just ran here to get on your agenda. So I apologize for not having that done, but it'll be done in a week's time.
Okay. Well, you understand that we want to be, supportive.
Right.
I always get a little concerned about contingency, but Cindy is a pro, and if she tells me that she is comfortable doing that, then I'm willing to do that.
Thank you for that. Appreciate it.
So you'll have safe serve. You will have, and you have done this in other parts of Thorne's with other businesses?
Well, we very infrequently serve alcohol in Thorne's.
Okay.
We do take advantage of the Arts Night Out license, by the way.
Yeah.
So probably twice a year we have a very small table with two bottles of wine that the artist manages for us. So we don't do this generally.
Right.
You know, we have a 6 or 7 person maintenance staff that I can utilize to make sure people aren't walking out into the hallway with open alcohol.
Well, that's what I'm concerned about.
Yeah, I mean, if that is a requirement of the permit, I'll make a commitment that we'll manage that issue.
Yeah, that's actually our requirement to impose on people. It's not something that we thought of. It's the state's requirement not to allow open containers to be leaving the event when it's a short-term event. And it looks like, will this be by invitation only?
The majority of attendees will be invite only. If there's customers in the store while the event's going on, we're not going to ask them to leave.
Fine.
The store is open until 8 that night, and we hope to stay open a few extra hours for the invitees.
Okay. Well, I don't have any further questions. I think it's pretty clear. As long as we've got our needs met, I don't have any problems. Okay. I'll make a motion to approve short-term wine and malt for the October 22nd, 2015 grand reopening party.
Contingent
on the license commission clerk being satisfied that all safe server and insurance requirements have been met. All in favor? Second? All in favor?
Thank you very much.
Thank you for your time. Well, next I see we're presenting the new guidelines from ABCC regarding extension of premises to patio and outdoor areas.
I just wanted to show you that it came in, that it has a requirement actually to...
I'm going to read this into the record. We'll read to the World Alcoholic Beverages Control Commission advisory regarding guidelines for extension of premises to patio and outdoor areas. On July 28, 2015, April of meeting, the Alcohol Beverages Control Commission approved amendments to its guidelines for extension of premises to patio and outdoor areas. These amended guidelines supersede the previously issued guidelines from 1989, and copies attached. As a reminder, all licensees must ensure they are in compliance with the laws of the Commonwealth of Massachusetts and that sale of alcoholic beverages take place only as authorized by applicable law. Questions, call them up. So the guidelines for extension of premises to patio and outdoor areas, they've got seven criteria now. One, alcoholic beverages cannot be served outside of the licensed establishment unless and until an application to extend the licensed premises has been approved. Two, an application to extend the premises must describe the area in detail, including dimensions, seating capacity, and maximum occupancy. Three, the premises must be enclosed by a fence, rope, or other means to prevent access from public walkway. Four, the outdoor area must be contiguous to the licensed premises with either A, a clear view of the area from inside the premises, or alternatively, B, the licensee may commit to providing management personnel dedicated to the area. Five, the applicant must have a lease or documents for the right to occupy the proposed area. Six, the licensing authority should consider the type of neighborhood and the potential for noise in the environment. Seven, preferred are outdoor areas where alcohol is served to patrons who are seated at the tables and where food is also available. And that is entered in our record. And that is good to know, because it's a major change. 17, proposal for amended rules and regulations. Form, or do you mean from?
From the local license commission. It's the rules for the extended hours. They had never been updated, and so I looked at them and updated them. It has always said rules, proposed rules.
Okay.
And it makes sense to have them actually be the rules, and I took out some of the language that was outdated that didn't make any sense anymore because they were proposed, and I changed it, I read it to Bill.
Okay.
It's
do we have copies of this that somehow I've missed? I would like to have a, I would propose that we table this until the next meeting so that we can actually read through it.
Yes.
If that's the,
yeah.
So we'll hold that until the next meeting. Okay. Do we have new business?
We do.
I was going to say, I see someone sitting back here very patiently.
I was actually extremely interested in what was going on.
Please come on up, sir. You obviously are the new business of the day.
All right.
And let's see, I did receive an inquiry asking for a late filing. This is Faces.
Yes, sir.
You are the savior of the town.
I am not, but my partners are.
Okay.
So I'm out, can help. Accent the savior, you know, help them.
You're all going to work together. We're very, very happy what you're doing. Let's just put it that way.
Thank you.
Just to express our appreciation. It's an icon of the business.
Absolutely. We understand that. We appreciate that. So
hopefully people will put their money where their appreciation.
Absolutely.
Okay, so you're looking to, let's see, what exactly are we looking for? Common Vic application, you're looking to open the cafe when?
Possibly the end of next week, if not, maybe a week after.
Okay.
I know when I thought I was pretty diligent about, you know, staying all steps with the building department.
There's always something, yeah.
It just slipped through the cracks. I misunderstood with the lady at the clerk's office, or she misunderstood what we had, or somewhere along the line. So Cindy thankfully emailed me yesterday and said, you need this, and I ran over, and I was like, you gotta get me on that. So I appreciate you sneaking out to the,
It's fine, it's really not.
I apologize for boring everybody, Doug, because I just want to sell sandwiches, I don't want to sell any boobs.
Well, I'll come there, because I don't drink, so right. Hey, I'll go have a sandwich. I definitely eat. So what do we need, if anything, from this applicant?
We have everything we need in order to hand him the license. I need the approval from the Board of, who are we waiting for now? It's the Board of Health?
The Board of Health is he came in yesterday, right before I came over to see you. He was very happy with the progress we're making.
He officially
completed his pre-inspection. And then, so once all my equipment and everything is installed, he'll do a final inspection. And at that point, he said that I would have the okay to go ahead. As long, you know, he didn't know anything about this device, this picture.
All right, so we're going to have to make our approval contingent on you receiving a Board of Health.
That's fine. And if she wants to, if you want to hang on to it until the Board of Health approves it, then that's
fine. Yeah, I don't have a pay yet.
So. Okay.
All right. How about the building inspector?
Louis was there actually today. I have my building permit.
Okay.
They approved our plan. That's right there. When he came over, I actually just caught him on the way out. He didn't even ask to talk to me. And he said that he was very happy with how everything was going. We're not making any real structural changes. We're really just adding some cabinetry and a couple of pieces of equipment. But he was very happy with that so far. So.
Okay. Is there anything else that you're aware of? Those are the two things I want to make a contingent.
Those are both of them.
All right. Anything that you want to add? Question? Ask about the menu, I suppose. But we're going to make a motion. I'm going to make a motion that we approve your application. However, it's going to be contingent on receipt of a valid Board of Health permit and a completed building permit.
Yes,
all in favor?
Aye.
Oh, just wanted to know, this is not a comparative. You mean complete inspection by the building department?
Yes.
Okay. All right.
They need to sign on with Cindy here.
Yep.
And she's very good about tracking those folks down. Best of luck, by the way.
Yes, and everybody in the town has been very, very accommodating, so I really appreciate that. So considering it's my first time doing something like this. So. Not in a restaurant, but doing it from scratch.
Best of luck.
Thank you very much.
Good luck.
Great day. Thank
you.
May all the students show up on your doorstep.
Not the first week, please.
Okay. Okay.
The pie bar, I promise you guys blew through the schedule pretty quick.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. What progress, if any, is on that with the pie bar? They have the applications in place? Is it?
It's been approved.
No public hearing other than this year? That was it? Okay. Thank you.
No, it's okay.
had everything set for Bill and, you know, he's good, yeah. What can I say? And it's two L's. R-E-A.
I'm sorry. Wow.
It's okay. It's real, not real. What can I say? I don't care. As long as you call me for dinner. There you go. Is there anything else I need to be signed at this point?
No, I can't speak for anything else.
Okay, well, the next thing on the agenda is approval of minutes from July 2nd, 2015 meeting and from the July 30th, 2015 meeting. I can speak to the July 2nd, 2015. I have reviewed them. I have no changes. However, I was not present at the July 30th, 2015 meeting, so I really can't vote to approve those, and I don't really know whether one... Yeah, okay. Why don't we... I'm going to make a motion we approve, absent you saying there's some change you saw, the July 2nd, 2015 minutes.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
I'll make a motion that we table the July 30th, 2015 meeting minutes for approval until the next meeting, when there will be two commissioners present who were actually present at that meeting. All in favor? Aye. I'm getting real long-winded. If that makes sense, is there any new business other than what we've just handled? Anything else before us today, Cindy?
No.
Second.